What's up, guys? It's Frockfordark. One tablet rules them all. The iPad. This is, without a shadow of a doubt, the most popular tablet in the world. While yes, it is true that Windows and Android tablets exist, but it wasn't always like that. Because about 10 years ago, Android tablets and kinda Windows tablets had some actual competition compared to the iPad. So since the current year is 2023, we're gonna go back 10 years and see what the tablet landscape was like back then. But we're not gonna be taking a look at these large tablets, instead we're gonna be taking a look at some smaller models. Because that's what I have. Representing iOS, we have the iPad Mini 2. Representing Android, we have the Samsung Galaxy Tab 3. And representing Windows, we have the HP Stream 7, which is from 2014. So is that technically cheating? No, because I'm not buying any more tablets. Each of these tablets released around the same time, excluding this one, and are mostly the same size, being about, 7 inches. Every inch matters, don't worry, guys. And also, each one of them personally has an interesting story to me. This iPad Mini is the newest one I've acquired. You may notice, if you're someone who knows your Apple products, why is there a black bezel on this silver iPad Mini? Shouldn't the bezel be white? And you'd be correct. I got this iPad in a lot of like 30 different iPads. When I first saw this iPad, it was basically just a battery in a case that was really nothing left of this thing. So I got bored and I was like, oh, what happens if I just chuck a screen on it? Not only does it work, but it's also not even iCloud locked. What I ended up doing was taking the screen off of an iPad Mini 2 and the touch digitizer, which is the glass layer which goes on top, from an iPad Mini 1, and it somehow manages to work. It does have this one little cracked bit, so it means this section of the screen doesn't have working touch. But other than that, it's a custom little iPad Mini that I've made, and I honestly really like how the black and silver looks. It's great. Up next, we have the Samsung Galaxy Tab 3. This thing I've had since 2013, and was pretty much my main little tablet for doing stuff on, while I only had my tiny little iPod Touch in before I had a phone, so this thing served me well. And then you have this thing. This is the oddball here. The screen on it is cracked, not of my fault, but because I left this somewhere and I believe one of my family members accidentally broke it. And I'm pretty sure there's a photo that exists on my iPod Touch of me making a poor man's Surface Pro with a keyboard on the bottom. So that was kind of funny, but yeah, this was really nifty. A tiny little 7-inch Windows tablet. Gee, I wonder how well it performs. Alright, if we go to about... oh god, Dan tablet. You can see how old I was when I got this. As you guys can see, it's an Intel Atom CPU with 1 GB of RAM. Oh, 64-bit. So it's extraordinarily anemic hardware, even for 2014. And trying to run Windows on it on this tiny little tablet with a really crummy battery life, I'm just gonna spoil it for you guys. This thing does not go well. But there you go, 64-bit processor, go shove Windows 11 on here. I dare you. Someone will do it pretty easily, I bet you. Let's take a look at these tablets. So here we have the iPad Mini, which you press the home button, and you know, you would swipe to unlock, but then they updated it. So now you have to press the home button, which is so stupid. And here we are, we're pretty much in the home screen of iOS 12. And yeah, it's an iOS product. It's pretty much exactly the same, except for the fact that you don't have widgets. Things are kind of similar on the Samsung side of things. Here we press the home button, and you can pretty much swipe anywhere you want to unlock it. And here we've got widgets, and for apps you can pretty much place them wherever you want. But also, one thing that we gotta love, or we actually hate, is the TouchWiz interface. So this is running Android 4.4 with Samsung's TouchWiz interface shoved on top of it with these glorious system sounds. And yeah, this is the 2013 Android tablet experience. And on the Windows side of things, you press the power button and you wait, you swipe up, and then here we are, running Windows 10 in portrait. Let's find out how much storage these things have. First, we're gonna look at the Samsung tablet. Let's press apps, and then we're gonna go to settings. So we're gonna go into storage, and you can see that this thing has 8 GB. but then also you can see 2 gigabytes of that is taken up by the system itself, so you're left with pretty much about 5 to 6 gigabytes to work with. Needless to say, me in 2013 constantly running into storage problems, which made this thing go slow. On the iOS side of things, we press the settings app, and then I just remembered the fact that my screen repair kind of failed and I have to turn it this way. And now we can use that half of the screen. And as you can see, this thing rocks 16 gigabytes. I don't know if that's the base model. I'll put the storage up on the screen. That's the options. I do it for the Samsung one too, and the HP one as well, why not? And finally, the Windows tablet. We press the start menu. We wait for the start menu to load, and then we press settings. And we wait for the settings to load. Actually, you know what? Since it's Windows, there's a much better way of doing this. So for Windows, we're just gonna go to File Explorer. We're gonna wait for File Explorer to load. And as you can see, we pretty much have 32 gigabytes, and then you have the weird Windows conversion thing, which makes it show up as 23.5 gigs. But because Windows is so large, you only get about 8 gigabytes to use or something like that. While this has the most storage, 32 gigabytes of Windows is kind of pathetic and borderline unusable. To go back home, we press the home button, and close. So let's take a look at some of the apps. Now, it took 4 years for this iPad to get a file browser. Hold on 1 second. So it took this iPad about 4 years in iOS 11 to get a file browser. And yeah, it's fairly basic. There's not much you can really do in it. You can look at your iCloud drive. You got some locations on your iPad. And that's about it. Pretty sure it was lacking external drive support at this time. It was really nasty in the iOS 11 slash 12 days. On the Android side of things, if we press apps and then we go to my files, as you can see, you get a File Explorer and it's actually fairly in depth. You can really go into the system directory and change and break a lot of things in here. But by far the best one, of course, has got to be Windows, because you get the full fat desktop File Explorer. And yeah, pretty much anything you can do on Windows, you can do on here, and it just works. No, it doesn't, because it's woefully underpowered. So yeah, it's a very interesting philosophy with these three. These two are complete opposites, while Android, to me, kind of strikes the perfect balance between iOS and Windows, but not at this time, because Android sucked at this time. We're going to test out the cameras now, and, well, we need something to photograph. Here we have a piranha plant plushie. Very colorful, very nice. On iOS, it's fairly simple. You just got your camera app here. 3, 2, 1. All right, so that's what the photo looks like. We've got nightlight on, so it's a little bit orangey, but you'll be able to see the photo properly once I pop it up on the screen. But I can say the dynamic range, and yes, I did turn HDR on, is, well, not that good. Compared to my main phone, the Pixel 7 Pro, which is what I'm filming with right now, I mean, there's kind of no competition between the two. On the Android side of things, it's a similar affair. You just go here and then you go into the camera app. And let me just tell you, the camera on this thing is a little bit shocking. I used to film Nintendo plush videos on this thing, so I'm very familiar with this camera. Oh, wanna know something really funny? Where's your tap to focus, huh? Oh, was that? You can't tap to focus? Yeah, that's right. You pretty much can't tap to focus, which is kind of crappy. And also the volume button is pretty much just used for zoom, and that's how you get a better zoom slider on here. 3, 2, 1. All right, let's look at this photo. Oh, that is extraordinarily washed out. You know what this reminds me of? The Samsung Galaxy Camera 2, which I made a video about. Click here to view it. And finally, probably the worst camera taking experience, the HP Stream 7. Okay, let's close this off so it has extra performance. And here's the camera. Oh wow, look at that, it's got tap to focus. Samsung. Oh, and it has a HDR button, maybe it won't look so bad. Oh, that's a pathetic camera sound. Listen to this. Yeah, actually, never mind. There's way too much contrast and there's like almost no detail preserved. That's a pretty nasty camera. But what could be worse than the rear camera? Oh god, it's the front camera. I can already tell this thing looks pretty nasty. 3, 2, 1. I hate that camera sound. Holy crap, this thing looks like a watercolor painting. There is absolutely no detail in there whatsoever. Next up, we got the Smeznug. 3, 2, 1. That genuinely looks really decent. It's got quite a bit of detail in there. Sure, the saturation and color depth is kind of pathetic, but hey, that's quite a bit of detail. I like that. And next up, we have the iPad. 3, 2, 1. It looks a little bright, but hey, it's obviously by far the best one. Also, it's very wide. It's a very wide front-facing camera, which can't be said about the other ones. Yeah, it's pretty much just a much better camera overall, so if you're doing FaceTiming... Okay, that's not zooming in, but if you're FaceTiming someone, great camera, works well. Thank you, Piranha Plant, your purpose has been served. While we're on the topic of the iPad, let's talk about general usability and multitasking. iOS 11 pretty much changed the lock screen in the control center and how it works. iOS 12 is the one that brought it up to here. So if we swipe down, right, I forgot about that. That part of the screen doesn't work. So if we swipe down, you pretty much just get your generic lock screen. I just remember how absurd of a change this was when they first added it. So then you can swipe back up, which I don't know why you can't just do that from the home screen. Like from the lock screen, why can't you just swipe up like that? Well, of course you can do it on devices with no home button. But what about the home button? If you pull down from this corner, you get the control center. I think this is Apple's worst designed element of iOS. Like, what, this tiny little section here is the only thing that can pull down control center? They really gotta come up with a new solution for this. This is absolutely terrible. Trying to teach anyone above the age of 35 how to do this is just... it's a task. But since this thing is running iOS 12, this is kind of the update where multitasking on iPad became kind of... good. So you can use the home button to do everything, like if you double click, but pretty much you can just treat it like an iPad without a home button and pretty much just use gestures for everything. And it works well. I like it. Because, you know, I'm used to my iPad Pro, which doesn't have a home button. So in terms of multitasking, you got a few options. You can open up an app and then open up the dock here and then pull out an app and then drag it on. As you can see, it's dropping frames here, so it's not actually as smooth as I remember. But yeah, here's files trying to load. I don't think it wants to load. I can't also get multitasking to work. But yeah, you can pretty much swipe that away and then swipe that back out whenever you want. Can you grab that? Okay, for whatever reason, it won't let me like split screen it, which is kind of dumb. I don't know if it's because this is an iPad mini, but you know, come on, man. Hey guys, so I quickly looked it up and apparently the iPad mini 4 is the lowest iPad mini that supports split screen, probably due to specs. But what's strange is that this iPad supports slide over instead of split screen, which is weird. I don't know, Apple's weird. But you can actually enable it through a jailbreak tweak, so there you go. If I try and go into mail and then let's just do something like messages. Okay, for some reason it won't let me do that. Yeah, the multitasking is extremely limited compared to what we have now, but you can swap that out and use it, I guess. Now, in the world of Samsung, I never actually really experimented with it back in the day. If we swipe down from here, turn that off, and then we turn that back on, multi-window. Ah, here we go, now we got that back on. So, I think if we tap gallery... okay, there we go. So now we can split screen that. It's not very responsive, but at least you can control it, actually, to a fair amount. Does it have drag and drop support? Not supported. Yep, there you go. Thanks for letting me know. So I found out how to open up the menu. Strangely, you hold the back button, which, by the way, menu button, back button, home button. And let's see, can we open up another app? If I drag this out... okay, that only does that. I don't think you can do floating windows. Some other Samsung devices did actually support the floating window thing, so that's interesting. This one doesn't, so this one goes in the trash. But of course, the tablet with the best multitasking has got to be the HP one. Why? Because it runs Windows, which is built for multitasking. Now let's see the power of this Intel Atom, which, as its name suggests, has the power of an atom. All right, so we're gonna open those apps up and we're gonna also go into the start menu and we're gonna open up a bunch of other apps. Let's see how much of this 1 gigabyte of RAM I can take up. Mind you, The Chromium version of Edge itself loves to take up 4 GB of RAM on my desktop. Yep, and this thing's already at a standstill. To be fair, I've opened up about 6 or 7 apps. Let's open up another one, why not? So you can actually do quite a bit of multitasking and get quite a bit of work done on here. You can move an app around in a floating window, and you can stack an infinite amount of floating windows on top of each other. You can tap this to make multiple desktops and see all of your open apps, and you can start drawing. There we go. Took a little bit, but we got there. And then we've opened up Edge, which is taking a bit. But then you can also right click, which you do by holding, and then a square appears. And you can tap Task Manager, and you can wait. This tablet teaches you the importance of patience. If you swipe in from this side, you can get a view of all your apps. There we go, finally did that. Task Manager finally launched. Oh, here it is. And then if you swipe this one open, you can get Action Center opened. It's figuring it out. There we go, it's got it. This brightness slider, do you know how many years it took them to add this to Windows 10? You had to manually tap the brightness button and you only had 4 options. We're currently using 100% of the CPU and 92% of the memory. This thing's really just, it's cycling hard, it's an absolute workhorse, and it's not going to stop until it gets the job done. Unless it blue screens. Do you know how many photos I have of this thing blue screening? It's great, I love it. It just blue screens and it's portrait and it's all formatted wrong. So apparently this has been up for 416 days. I'm fairly certain I shut this thing down. Apparently not. But yeah, kind of just goes to show you. If you're opening up more than one app on this thing, it becomes basically unusable. I tried to run Minecraft on here several years ago, just I could not get it working. There's really not much you can do on this thing. So yeah, what did we learn in this video? Well, there's kind of a reason why the iPad dominates. Simply due to the fact that, you know, it's got a better screen, made out of better materials, it's thinner. Like, just objectively, the iPad is just the better tablet out of all of these. They can be used for different tasks. You can mod these ones to run newer versions of their operating systems. But I bet one of you guys who are watching this video is absolutely just dying to shove Linux on this thing and seeing what you can do with it. So go do that. But yeah, pretty much these kind of iPads, they run alright. If you can get a bunch of old apps on here, they still work pretty well to this day and pretty smoothly. But yeah, pretty much if you know how to kind of make these tablets run for your own purpose and do stuff, you can pretty much still get a use out of these things still. But yeah, pretty much compare the absolutely terrible plastic design and the fake metal Samsung kept using compared to the real metal Apple actually used on their products at the time. You can pretty much just see why iPads pretty much dominate the landscape today. One more thing I should say about the hardware. This has a microSD card slot. The back looks like it should come off, but you can't actually take that off. Well, you're not intended to. And of course, the iPad's got nothing besides its lightning port and its headphone jack, which is up here. Headphone jack for this is on the top, and this has got a headphone jack and an upside down microB connector. But truly the most interesting thing about this is that it's a Windows tablet with the back that you can take off. As you can see, the battery is only 3000 milliamp hours and is strangely scratched. That is very concerning. This is where you put in your microSD card slot, and this is how you tear it apart. You can actually just take out these screws, take off this panel, and then you're pretty much into the internals. And no, you cannot upgrade the storage or RAM on here. They are soldered on. Well, I mean, you can chuck an SD card slot in, but you get what I mean. In terms of modern alternatives, Samsung's new tablets seem to pretty much just be iPad Pro knockoffs, but they're decent knockoffs. They're constructed well, they've got OLED screens, and they might genuinely be a viable option for some people. And also the Pixel tablet just released, which is actually really cool. I do like the idea of it converting into a stand and it not trying to focus on trying to be a computer as well. It's just strictly a tablet with no keyboard. Kinda nice. On the Windows side of things, you have the Surface Pro. These things are actually really nice. They popularized probably the best design for a kickstand ever created, which means you can prop it up and pretty much tilt it down onto any angle you want for drawing or watching stuff. And if you hate using Windows with a touchscreen, boom, now it's a laptop. I'm really a fan of the Surface line, and quite frankly, this keyboard feels amazing. This trackpad is really good for, you know, this kind of thing. And yeah, these things are great if you want a real computer, because tablets are not computers. I'm telling you that much. Tablets are tablets. You can do computery things on them, but they're at their element when they're being used as a tablet. But if that's too big for you, then why don't you use the itty-bitty Surface Go, which is an absolutely tiny, adorable little Microsoft tablet with the same kickstand, and it's just a little mini version of it. I love it. Too bad it's, like, really underpowered, though. And then, of course, you got the iPad, which, if you're gonna get a tablet, just get an iPad. Unless it's something you very specifically need, you know, you got the pencil, everything just runs great. Just dropped it. And yeah, best all-around tablet. So, that's pretty much it. My name's Frogfidelic, you can say however you want, I really don't care. New videos whenever I want. That's the end of the video. Thanks for watching.